早晨各位同事，2021
Members, good morning. May I call to order a meeting of the Bills Committee on Inland Revenue Amendment Number 4, Bill 2018. This is the second meeting. We've just formed a quorum. Please invite the administration to join us now. Good morning, officials from the administration. At the meeting dated the 15th of June, we discussed the policy direction of the bill, and then there were some follow-up issues raised at the last meeting, and the administration has prepared a written reply. It's paper number CB21729/1718(02). And our list of outstanding items is CB21729/1718(01). Both have been served to members. Mr. Fong, Deputy Secretary, can you please walk us through the administration's response, and then I'll open the floor to members for questions. Thank you, Chairman, and good morning, members. The first issue on the paper is right to equality. At the last meeting, some members raised some concern about the sentence. The right to equality is not absolute and may be subject to permissible limitations. Now, we're not saying that under some circumstances the right to equality could be infringed on. And we have set out the details in the paper, and our views are consistent with that of the members concerned. And the second issue is condition of parents and grandparents as specified relative. We're going to follow the approach for dependents in the current IL. And the third issue is review of the effectiveness of the concessionary deduction. I'd like to say that the tax deduction proposed is not meant to be the key or sole incentive for the public to purchase certified plans. And after the scheme is in place for a while, we are going to review its effectiveness. And the third point is about the definition of siblings, whether adopted siblings would be included. After discussion with the DOJ, we agree that there should be an amendment to this. If the taxpayer concerned is an adopted child, then the natural children of his adopted parents should also be covered in the definition. Thank you. All right, Mr. Pierre Chen, Dr. Pierre Chen, I will not set a time limit in the first instance. Thank you. Yes, are you going to review the effectiveness of the tax deduction proposal? Now, what about the items, for instance, for major illnesses and cancer? Are you going to increase the amount of claim, and how are you, or is there any mechanism or formula for adjusting the benefits in this concerned? The benefits per month. On the one hand, medication costs are escalating because of increased charges from pharmaceutical companies. So cancer drugs are very expensive. And then insurance companies will not increase the benefits for purchasing drugs. So we're at a dilemma. Will you do anything to address this issue? Can you, for instance, adjust the benefits? And what mechanism do you have to adjust the benefits under this category? Please don't say that you're going to discuss it within yourselves. And if there is no mechanism, then this problem cannot be dealt with. Deputy Secretary, thank you. For benefits for non-surgical treatment of cancer, in our discussion with the insurance sector, we are saying that under the standard plan, $80,000 per year is appropriate at this stage. Of course, we can increase the amount of benefits, but then that will mean higher premiums too, so we have to strike a balance. We believe that other than the standard plan, there will be flexi plans from the insurance companies, and the benefits for this category will be higher. As regards the adjustment mechanism, in future, in addition to the standard plan, we expect there will be flexi plans in the market. So when these plans are available, we'll look at the coverage, and then we will consider when is the appropriate time for adjusting the benefits and benefit limits under the standard plan. So we do not have a fixed timetable for doing this, but for sure, about 1 year after the plan is launched, we will look at the penetration rate, and then we will decide on the way forward. Because it is a brand new scheme, at this stage we cannot give an undertaking as to when we are going to adjust the benefit limits under the standard plan. Dr. Pierre Chen. So I've asked this question a number of times. Last time you said that 2 years after implementation, and today you said 1 year, you're going to review the benefit limits. But we have inflation every year, and drug costs are going to change annually. If you ask me whether the limits should be adjusted next year, even without any meeting, I can tell you that this is the case. Well, to a couple of years down the road, you might be promoted to another post, and another official will come to meet with us, and we may have to discuss it at the panel first before we can start a discussion with the administration. It's very likely that next time when we discuss this issue, you will have already been promoted and received a high salary. So the benefit limits you have settled with insurance companies, but the adjustment of such limits is a very real issue. If you don't have any mechanism, then the limits might be entirely out of tune with the market. Mr. Fong, we entirely appreciate Dr. Pierre Chen's question. We will see whether benefit limits can really reflect the market situation. And if they can't, after taking into account a basket of factors, we're going to adjust the limits. But then there will also be flexi plans, so we will have to consider the actual needs in due course. Mr. Fong, can you tell us, under the standard plan, what is the range of benefit limits for critical illnesses? Or do you have such information for us for a standard plan? Under the standard plan, well, we do not have this concept of critical illness, because at the market, benefits for critical illnesses is a lump sum one-off compensation. So we are talking about surgical expenses here, and if there is a critical illness that requires surgical treatment, then there will be benefits. And we talk about non-surgical treatment of cancer and that will be chemotherapy and radiotherapy, and the claims are on an accountable basis. Well, radiotherapy and chemotherapy, there will be benefit limits. Do you have any floor or ceiling for benefit limits of such a treatment in a standard plan?
Well, under the standard plan, for non-surgical and cancer treatment and so on, the limit is $80,000. So with regard to the administration's response, I'll open the floor to members' response, or do members have any questions? Yes, Mr. Ray Chen. Chairman, can I look at the proposed amendment by the administration with regard to definition of siblings, including taxpayers and also their spouses, parents, and also their adoptive children and so on. So can I deal with that now? So I'd like to know if they would be covered. So I'll have to listen to the situation, because this is very much a situational thing. All right, if the taxpayer is a foreign same-sex couple, so they've also legitimately adopted children, and then one party of the same-sex couple, had married to a heterosex spouse, and they also had child, and then for the children who have been legally adopted by the taxpayer, so and also for one of the couple, all right, let's say that the natural child of that parent has become a Hong Kong citizen, so you're talking about the half-brother or half-sister of that taxpayer, and in both scenarios, you can have adoptive children in both marriages. One is a heterosexual marriage and the other is a same-sex marriage. Okay, so can you talk about the two scenarios, and can you also cover both? Sorry, Deputy Secretary. Yes, I'll ask Mr. Chiu to help. All right, concerning Mr. Ray Chen's question, I hope I've understood it correctly. All right, there is a taxpayer, and at present, he's a party to a same-sex marriage, and they got married overseas, and then for this taxpayer, he had an earlier a former heterosexual marriage, right? All right, let me put it again. Okay, so this taxpayer had a same-sex marriage, and his partner adopted a child in his former marriage, and then for that same-sex spouse, he had been married to a heterosexual spouse, and they also had children. So under this definition, so they would also be defined as siblings, right? So for this same-sex spouse who had adopted this child in his former marriage, and also for the son that he had with his ex-spouse, so that taxpayer's half-brother or sister, both as Hong Kong citizen, and they've also taken out the VHIS, so would they be able to claim tax deduction? Can you put it in more simple terms? Okay, so you're talking about same-sex marriage, but then there was a heterosexual marriage beforehand, and they had children beforehand, and you're talking about half brothers and sisters now. So would they be eligible for this tax deduction? So I hope that you understand what I was saying. Yes, I understood it as soon as you put it the first time. Okay. Yes, sorry. Mr. Chen, I think this is a challenging question. I'll have to talk to the DFJ colleague before I can give you an answer. So can I, do you need a few minutes? So you can give us an answer in writing, or you can also talk to your colleague now. So please make sure that you understand my question properly. Yes, my understanding is that with regard to the idea of adoption, it has to be recognized by Hong Kong's laws. So this is a practical situation. All right, let's first refer to the first scenario. So we're not talking about whether or not it's by way of adoption. Okay, you're talking about a same-sex couple who got married overseas and they adopted some children. Okay, for the adopted children, if they are recognized by Hong Kong's laws, so that's the premise. That's the premise. Okay, and afterwards, for the spouse of this same-sex marriage who had an earlier marriage, and they also had a child in his earlier marriage. All right, let me simplify this further. Okay, this is a taxpayer, and he or she was adopted by a same-sex couple. So the three are now Hong Kong citizens. Will they be eligible for tax deduction? So this is a more simplified version. I think the crux of the matter is whether or not the same-sex couple would be able to legally adopt children. Will that be recognized by Hong Kong's laws? So would the child be regarded as a legally adoptive child of that couple? I think this is a rather complicated legal issue. So I'd like to know if you have any initial response. Well, thank you, Chairman, for your assistance. Let me try and answer the question raised by Mr. Ray Chen. I think the crux of the matter is about the adoption, whether or not that adoption is recognized by the laws of Hong Kong. With regard to the child from the heterosexual marriage, well, under the current law, definitely that that would be treated as the child of the taxpayer. So between the two, I think that would depend on whether or not the adoption would be recognized by Hong Kong's laws. So will that be recognized now? So do you have any idea about that? All right, if it's a single person adopting a child, will that be recognized by Hong Kong's laws? Can the DFJ answer that question? Will a single person adopting a child be recognized by the laws of Hong Kong? Well, I'll try to answer the question raised by Mr. Ray Chen just now. Well, I think it depends on the adoption ordinance to see if the different scenarios would be recognized by the Hong Kong laws. So that was a very challenging question. So you're talking about same-sex marriage and whether or not the children adopted by the same-sex couple will be recognized by Hong Kong's laws. I think it's hard for me to explain very briefly, so I'll have to check. Well, I'd just like to raise one more point. All right, if a single person is allowed to legally adopt a child, then in Hong Kong, I don't know whether or not we have such precedents, because in overseas countries, single persons would be allowed to adopt children. If that is the case, then will Hong Kong law recognize a single person adopting a child? If that is recognized in Hong Kong, then for same-sex marriage, and if you do not recognize that, then you will have to justify that, right? So do you have any initial legal analysis? Okay, he'll have to go back and he'll have to come up with a more detailed analysis afterwards. Okay, Mr. Ray Chen, do you have any further questions? No, not for the time being. All right, Dr. K.K. Kwok was not here. So Mr. Felix Chung, do you have any questions? No, I don't have for the time being, but then I will be asking some later. Yes, Chairman, I'll wait for the second round. Dr. Chen, yes, I'll wait for the second round. It's already the second round now. Okay, under the VHIS bill, with regard to commission and also premium and also administrative costs, will the administration be regulating that, or will there be any restriction imposed by the administration on how these should be charged? Chairman, well, Hong Kong is a free economy. I think under that premise, the administration does not have to regulate on the premiums and so on. So that's what we thought. But then we believe that there is a need for us to do something about it first. First, under the VHIS, we would require the insurer to undertake some ambulatory care or procedures. That would also help to lower the medical costs, because in the past, in many circumstances, the patient will have to stay in the hospital overnight before he's eligible for making claims. But then under the VHIS, if that can be done at the ambulatory center, he should not be required to stay overnight in the hospital. So that's number one for reducing cost. Second is about transparency of the premium structure. So whether it's the standard plan or the flexi plan, for all insurers joining the scheme, they would have to come up with a scheme that will be charged on the basis of age rather than other things. And also for the details of the premiums, everything will have to be uploaded onto the website. In the future, we're going to set up a VHIS website so that everybody will be able to look at it. So that would be fair competition, because everything will be transparent, and that would also create a better competitive environment for the insurers to compete in a level playing field. And that would also help to control or contain healthcare costs. Dr. Chen, I think my question is very simple. So the answer is in the negative. But how come he's coming up with such a lengthy reply? Well, so I think usually you should have, if it's in the negative, you'll have to come up with a longer answer. Well, there is another meeting going on right now. It's about the links charges in wet markets and so on. So there is a subcommittee on this. And then there is a welfare panel meeting next door. And they are also talking about the administrative costs charged by NGOs, and there is no way that we can regulate them. And now, when it comes to MPF and other things, after so many years, yes, there is market competition. So in a free economy, there is no way that you can deal with this. So if right from the beginning, if you don't do anything about it, then next time, well, so next time, you're going to become the permanent secretary instead of the deputy secretary. And if you do not do anything about it, it will be the public who will suffer. So for those policymakers who are here, please do bear that in mind, because that would affect the effectiveness of the scheme, and that would also affect our future discussion in this council on the scheme. So please do bear that in mind. Yes, deputy secretary, point taken. Yes. All right, for the link read. All right, this is an oligopoly. And then for the others, my personal view is also an oligopoly. So you're talking about restrictive competition, but then for the insurance market, there should be more than one service provider, and therefore there should be competition in the market. That's my personal opinion. But then I hope that the government will pay more attention to the level of a premium and also the administrative cost. So under the policy, to what extent will that take up the premium? So you will have to be very mindful of that, because for these policies, for many people in Hong Kong, it's very important if you want it to be effective. Yes, anything else? Yes, Felix Chung, you raised your hand. Yes, Felix Chung. Thank you, Chairman. Well, Dr. Chen Puyin asked a very good question. So that's about the administrative cost. Right now, we have two plans. One is the standard plan. The other is the flexi plan. Well, under the standard plan, basically, it's a very standardized policy. So under that plan, can the administrative cost be fixed as well? Because when you design this plan, when you try and confirm this policy with the insurer, so everything should be quite clear and simple. So can the administrative costs be fixed under standard plans? And second, well, after the introduction of VHIS, so how many people will be participating in that scheme, because they'll be able to get tax deduction? So how many people will be joining the standard plans and how many flexi plans? So have you done any projection? Yes, Deputy Secretary. Well, let me first answer the second question first. According to our projection, 3 years down the road, we hope that about 1.5 million people will be joining the VHIS, including both standard plans and flexi plans. According to our initial projection, well, the standard plan will take up about 20-30%, and then the flexi plan will take up about 80%.
And that's point number one. And secondly, whether we will fix the administrative fee under the standard plan, we believe this is going to be difficult. As a matter of principle, the government should not do that. And secondly, when a person takes out, when the insurance companies sells such plans, they do it together, so it's difficult to separate two. Mr. Zhong, I don't understand what is meant by doing it together and it's difficult. And he also said that as a matter of principle, he should not control the administrative fee, but for the default MPF scheme, the administrative fee is fixed at 0.75%. And why can't we do the same for VHIS? Well, as I said, in insurance market, there is competition. There are 40 to 50 insurers selling similar products. So Hong Kong, that is quite considerable. And there is choice for consumers. I think the most appropriate approach is to enhance the transparency of the market and allow more information released to the public. And in the long term, we hope that administrative fees can be lowered. Now, this is an VHIS. And insurance company can choose to join or not. And we have to understand that we have to be consistent. And therefore, we tackle this problem with free market principles. Mr. Zhong, of course, we support free economy. But you cap the you can put a cap to the administrative fee to ensure that first they will not be making losses, but then below this cap, insurance companies can compete. It's just like the default MPF schemes. Am I correct? Mr. Zhong, if you consider the MPF A ordinance and its regulations, there are very strict disclosure requirements when it comes to administrative fees, but the administration may want to supplement. I'd like to know whether insurance products are required to disclose their administrative fees. I don't think that the insurance industry is able to do that. I don't know whether my observation is correct. Perhaps the Undersecretary can advise on this. As far as we understand, the Federation of Insurers collects such data from insurance companies. So they do have information on benefit limits and the total limits and also the administrative costs. But we have to understand that this is a voluntary scheme and not compulsory in nature. For a compulsory scheme, the approach will be very different. Some members asked how come for in other areas, the administrative fees are lower. This is because in these jurisdictions, health insurance is mandatory everyone has to join, and it will only be effective if it is compulsory. Otherwise, the difficulty is because we want the scheme to be voluntary, so we have to follow the current market mechanism. Mr. Zhong. Yes, I understand that this is not mandatory, but you offer tax deduction as an incentive, so naturally people will be attracted to take out VHIS for tax deduction purpose, because they do not enjoy the same if they procure other insurance products. So people will be attracted to buy VHIS because of tax deduction, and tax deduction is also offered if you buy VHIS for your family members. So you expect that within 3 years, 1.3 million people will have taken out VHIS. That means insurance companies' administrative costs are bound to fall by and by. It's just like the DIS for under MPF schemes. You have not forced people to switch to DIS, but because it is because of the low administrative fees, people have been attracted to turn to that. Now, for the default investment strategy, DIS, the fund manager will automatically place the benefits under DIS. I think Mr. Zhong is not too happy with the administration's answer, since according to the administration, Federation of Insurers does collect such information, and you're going to disclose information on different VHIS on your website. Can you consider adding a column on administrative fees on your website? Is that possible? We will consider that. Thank you. Mr. Zhong? Dr. Kwakaki, so you did raise your hand, right? Thank you. Chairman, just this month, the research division of the council issued a report which is very interesting and very objective. The report pointed out two things. That is, within 2 years, 1.5 million people will be attracted, or plans, the government plans to attract 1.5 million people to take out VHIS. That is rather unimaginable. And then the fees will be the administrative fees will be as high as 37% of the premium. Well, this is interesting. Now, if it is really a free market, it is really consumer's choice. But now you are using public money to fund part of the premiums. So it's close to $800 million per year. Well, for people waiting for a target therapy medicine, the total cost for a year may be $800 to $1 billion. And then if you apply for a subsidy under the community care fund, you will have to receive very stringent means tests. Even the whole family will be subject to such means tests, and the subvention or subsidy will only be dispersed in phases. If you have almost depleted all your savings, then you receive a higher level of subsidy, and you should be helping people in the community. And strangely, you have chosen to give financial support to people who are going to take out VHIS. You are using public money to do that, and you have not addressed the point of administrative fees. Because you are spending public money on this scheme, why can't you have a say on the administrative fee? And for premiums, under the current proposal, there is no cap on premiums. So this version is even worse than the previous version. And that is before this revised version, there was an estimate on the where there was the high-risk pool proposed, we were, of course, very worried. The premiums will be two times that of normal premiums, so you have to pay $10,000 or $12,000, even $36,000 if you're over 65 years old. I don't know how many people over aged 65 will be able to afford $36,000 to take out in health insurance. Given that the government is subsidizing the scheme, how can you disregard the premium levels and the administrative fees? Can you tell us the logic behind that? Mr. Fong, I have to stress that this is a consensus after public consultation, and we have taken on board views from the public, and the scheme is to be a voluntary one. So the overriding principle is it is a voluntary scheme, whether on the part of insurers and the insured. Well, perhaps I ask a more specific question. Now, if people take out their own insurance coverage, you, of course, will not control the administrative fees. But for schemes that the government subsidize by means of tax deduction, isn't it reasonable for you to control the administrative fees? Now, if I take out travel insurance and other kinds of insurance, it is my voluntary choice. Yet, you are now using public money to subsidize such schemes. For instance, we have someone waiting for a cancer drug, and the government has told him that, well, we don't have enough money for you, and you have to be we have to put you to a means test. And now suddenly you encourage a person to take out health insurance scheme, and you may use it in the future. I'm not asking you to cap the administrative fees of all health insurance schemes. I'm only talking about HIS where there is tax deduction. So why can't you put a cap and then require the administrative fees to be lowered year by year? Isn't it a good thing? Thank you. We understand Dr. Kwok's concern. First, we are not subsidizing the insurers under this tax deduction. We are providing financial support to members of the public. This is an extra incentive for people to take out certified plans so that they can be confident in them, and they can be confident that they can benefit from such plans. And the tax deduction is an extra incentive for people to take out VHIS. So if they use healthcare services in the private sector, in the long term, we will lessen the burden on our public sector. So we are not subsidizing insurance companies. Given that we have a free economy in Hong Kong, we don't believe it is appropriate for us to regulate the administrative fees. Now, I'm not asking you, yes, you are not directly subsidizing insurance companies, but according to our research report, 37% of the money will become administrative fees. According to the administration, the total cost in tax deduction will be $800 million. That means about $7 million will be administrative fees for the insurance companies. Now, if it is a normal market behavior, we will not regulate it, of course. But then you are using public money to subsidize these plans. For certified plans, insured persons can receive a tax deduction. So how difficult it is for you to put a cap on the administrative fees? Insurance companies join on a voluntary basis using finding from our own secretariat, it will be 37%. If you think that in the long term the public will benefit, you can say that now, because the government is subsidizing taxpayers to buy VHIS, you have the right to benefit members of the public more by means of your subsidy. So why can't you fix the administrative fees at, say, 20% or 30%? At least there will be some benchmark for people to follow. Mr. Fong, I understand Dr. Kwok's concern, but let me stress once again that this is a voluntary scheme entirely. And secondly, we have no intention, nor is it right, to regulate the operation of the insurance sector. No, you cannot regulate the whole industry. You're just regulating plans subsidized by you. No, we're not subsidizing insurance companies, but you are subsidizing members of the public.
So, you should come up with a reasonable administrative cost concerning the part that you're subsidizing the public in terms of premium. So, would that not be reasonable? Well, let me stress once again, we are not subsidizing the insurers. I'm not arguing with you about that. So, I'm talking about subsidizing the public. We're providing an incentive for the public to take up such insurance policies. And under the circumstances, in a free economy, we don't think that we should regulate the insurers' administrative cost. Dr. Kwok, however, had you tried to put it to the administration, they're going to give you the same answer. I think this is outrageous because I think it's very controversial because you're actually not protecting the consumers. That's not fair because you're actually forcing them to take out such insurance policies. Well, I think, Deputy Secretary, I've already asked the administration to consider this. That is for administrative cost, for different health insurance schemes, that should be included in the website so that the public will be able to decide for themselves if they want to take out a particular insurance policies. Well, for those who have joined us just now, so Helena Wong and also another member, do you have any questions? Okay, if not, then Felix Chung. Thank you, Chairman, Deputy Secretary. Different political parties and also members with different political affiliations have asked the same question. They've all asked you to consider the administrative cost. You shouldn't just blame it on the free market because, for the investment fund, it's a very good example that something can be done about it and the administration has done it. So you shouldn't just say that, in a free market for the vacancy tax, that would also affect the free market's operation. Still, you have introduced it. So the same goes for this. Okay, you expect that about 1.5 million people will be taking out the VHIS in 3 years' time. And as a result, they'll be able to get the $8,000 tax deduction. So how much do you expect to forgo in 3 years' time in terms of tax revenue? So we'll be receiving $800 million less every year. So it's not a very substantial amount of money. That being the case, and can I suggest this? I'd first like to ask you a question. How did you come up with the $8,000 tax deduction? Why not $7,000, $10,000, $15,000, and so on? Well, for the $8,000 that we have decided on, that would enable some 90% of those who have taken out the standard plan to be able to have the entire year's premium to be tax deductible. Yes, Mr. Chung. All right. So 90% of those taking out the standard plan would be able to get their annual premium tax deductible. So what about flexi plans? Well, we are not able to do any projection on that because we don't know the premium level for flexi plans because that will be very diversified depending on the coverage. Well, just now the Deputy Secretary said that for flexi plans they can come up in all forms. Definitely the premium will be a lot higher because the coverage would be more comprehensive. So why can't they get a higher tax deduction if they take out flexi plans, in particular for the middle class? If you want to help them, definitely they would not just be taking out the standard plans because, as we said at the last meeting, the Deputy Secretary told us that standard plans would be more suitable for those who just start to work. because their income is not very high. That's why they'd rather take out the standard plan first. But then for those who are very responsible for their families and for those from the middle class, it would be more attractive for them to take out flexi plans. But then for middle class families, they are not eligible for many welfare benefits. They would not just be going to the public hospital when they are ill. So I urge the administration to consider that for those taking out flexi plans, the tax deduction should be higher, say $15,000, $20,000. That would benefit the middle class more. So would that be considered? Deputy Secretary. Yes, Deputy Secretary. Well, I can provide more figures to members for your consideration. But when we do the projection, well, under the standard plan, the average premium would be $4,800 a year. In other words, there is still some room for that to be turned into a flexi plan if the tax allowance is $8,000. And if we like to target the younger people who are fresh grads, for example, from 20 to 24, according to our projection, their annual premium is $2,400. In other words, the tax allowance of up to $8,000 would also enable them to take out a flexi plan. So $8,000 is not a low amount. Yes, of course, we understand that by the time when they age, the premium will go higher. But then in our design, we have already factored that in. So when we go to clause by clause in a moment, we'll be explaining in greater detail. That is for the dependents and also specified relatives. There is no limit on the number of specified relatives. For example, if you have two brothers taking out insurance policy for the parent, each of them will be entitled to $8,000 tax allowance. So that would already deal with the elderly person taking out the policy. So we believe that $8,000 is appropriate, and it should not be set at too high a level. Yes, Felix Chung. Yes, I was going to ask about elderly persons. Well, for elderly persons, once the insurer knows that, for elderly person, if they want to have a body check, then of course they might have different problems like high blood glucose and also hypertension and so on. So they would have these chronic problems. So for premiums for elderly persons, that would be higher. But then if two brothers are taking that out for the parent, then that would, each of them will be entitled to $8,000 tax allowance. But then in modern day society, very often people would just have one or two children. And then even if there are two brothers, it doesn't mean that both of them would be willing to take out policies for their parents. So there are various factors that have to be borne in mind. So has the administration considered that? How can you help the elderly persons? That's why I was saying that in particular for elderly persons and also for flexi plans. So I'm referring to flexi plans. I hope that the tax allowance can be higher. Yes, Deputy Secretary. Yes, I understand the concern of the member. In the process we have already considered that we are already rather relaxed. Husband and wife are taxpayers, so they'd be able to get $16,000 for buying out the same plan. And if they have, they can also take out an insurance policy worthy of $32,000. So there is already some room for maneuvering. It's already rather relaxed because we do not have an upper limit for specified relatives, and to a certain extent, that would already deal with the problem of elderly persons having to pay a higher premium for health insurance policies. So we have to strike a balance. Yes, Mr. Chung, any further questions? Yes, I'd like to clarify this with the Deputy Secretary. Right now, for every healthcare policy, tax allowance is $8,000. All right, I can take out 4 insurance policies for my parent and grandparents, right? So if I have 10 grandchildren, so each of them will have $8,000 so that they can take out health insurance for their grandparents and so on. Well, if they ask for tax deduction, that's okay. But then I'm not saying that there are people who are not filial pious to their parents or grandparents, but then if their income is limited, then they simply will not be able to afford that. So I think this is an ideal situation. That might be true. But then in reality, it might not be the case. Yes, nothing to add? No. Okay, Dr. K.K. Kwok. Yes, Chairman, I'd like to ask this. The target is to have 1.5 million people taking out the insurance policies. All right, in 2017, what about the median income per capita? It's $15,000. What about those earning less than that? It's 44%. So for the upper bound, it's 56%. So you're talking about labor force, and according to the projection done by the Secretariat, about 2.4 million people have already taken out health insurance. So for those earning more than $15,000 a month, you're talking about those earning more than the median income, you're talking about some 90% or some 100%. So for the rest, they're actually the low income earners. So Deputy Secretary, you're trying to force more people who are not having too many means to take out health insurance. What meaning does it have? So for those who can afford it, most of them have already taken out health insurance. Over 90% of them have taken out health insurance policies already. So why on earth are you trying to force the rest who are earning less to take out insurance policies? What's the meaning of that? So you know that they don't have money at all, and still you're forcing them to take out health insurance. According to census, well, there are some 2 million people who have taken out hospital IHIPs, indemnity hospital insurance products. So you're talking about some 2.4 to 3 million insurance policies. So that's very similar to what we projected. But then under the VHIS, in the design of the scheme, we also require the insurers to provide an opportunity or a choice for the existing client so that they can also convert to the new VHIS. So out of the 1.5 million people that we expect to take out health insurance, we hope that some of them would be migrating from existing health policies to the new VHIS. So we are not talking about 1.5 million new policies. But then out of the existing health policy holders, we expect that quite a substantial number of them would have taken out health insurance that would not be helpful at all, because the coverage is simply too inadequate. We have also done some projection, and half of the insurance policy holders simply do not use them, because they would still be going to the public hospital when they have illnesses. And one of the reasons why they do not go to the private hospital, that's because of the loading that they will have to pay out of their own pocket before they can get any compensation from the insurers. So we're looking at the minimum requirements so that for those in need, after taking out the health insurance policies, they'll be able to go to the private sector for health care or medical care, or else it would just be a waste of money if they can't use it. So that's the whole point. Okay, now let's turn to the reality. Okay, according to your plan, if they do not stay in the hospital and if they want to take cancer treatment, according to the projection, is about $30,000. So it's about $35,000 or $36,000. All right, it's $80,000 according to the estimate. All right, for chemotherapy or radiotherapy, do you know how much it would cost? You should have known it. So if they have to go for radiotherapy or chemotherapy, how much would that cost you? So to what extent will this policy help? Deputy Secretary, I've already responded to an earlier question similar to that. Well, for similar policies right now, that would not be covered. So for things, for plans that are similar to the standard plans, they do not have that, and we have already included that under the standard plans. So as a start, if the coverage is too high, that would also affect the premium. That's why we have to strike a balance. So we have set that at about $80,000 a year. So we know that if they have to go for chemotherapy sessions all the time throughout the year, then that would not be adequate. And therefore, for insurance companies, they would also come up with flexi plans that would have higher coverage. And I expect that some of them simply would not impose any limit on individual types of treatment. So they would be talking about the overall cap for the entire year.
So we believe there will be such flexi plans, and there won't be any cap on the number of sessions. And we want to, the design of the standard plan is such that ordinary members of the public can afford it as far as possible. And therefore, the premium, we have to strike a balance between the premium and the benefit limits. And under a flexi plan, you can have higher benefits, and more expensive treatment may then be covered. Dr. Kwok, I do understand. Now, if you walk into a restaurant, I know that a fresh cream cake is delicious, but I can only afford an ordinary bun. You talked about $100,000 with no limit, and this is the premium. If people use the flexi plans, the premiums will go higher and higher. You ask people to take out more coverage. Now, if a person can afford it, of course he would want to. Now, if somebody has already taken out your standard plan, $80,000 for non-surgical treatment is insufficient. So for the latest treatment, it can be $100,000 in drug per month, and people will come to seek assistance. So $20,000, $240,000 will already exceed the limit. Now, if a person has taken out a standard plan or a flexi plan, and yet he is terminal with a critical illness, the government should help them to pay for the drugs in full. Now, assuming that I were a naive citizen, I was told by the government that this is something good, there will be tax deduction, and I should take out VHIS, so I did. Unfortunately, I suffered a major illness, and I can only have $80,000 as the benefit limits. And of course, then the secretary, deputy secretary said that you can take out plans where the premium is $10,000 a month, but I can't afford that, and now I run into trouble. Doesn't the administration have the moral obligation to help me? Now, I'm only talking about cancer or major illnesses, because I am hanging in the middle of the air. I don't know whether I should start the treatment or not. I can only claim at most $80,000 under a standard plan. So in such cases, shouldn't the administration consider giving some support? Otherwise, the government is being very irresponsible. I'm just talking about cancer. Deputy Secretary, I understand that another team within the Bureau is reviewing the mechanism under the Samaritan Fund to fund expensive drugs for cancer or other diseases. I think expensive drugs should be dealt with elsewhere and not under the VHIS. But you are encouraging people to use the private sector, and even if he has cancer, he is encouraged to use the private sector healthcare services. And if they have run out of money, you ask them to seek help under the Samaritan Fund. So you're being contradictory. What really do you mean? No, I am not being self-contradictory. I said right from the beginning that VHIS is but one of the policies to tackle the various problems in our healthcare services. So VHIS is just one measure, and I can't use it to tackle all things, including expensive drugs. As I said, expensive drugs is being taken care of under another topic. We cannot lump everything into one issue, otherwise it will be too complicated. No, I'm being very explicit. I am not mixing things. We will have a group of people who have taken out certified plans by the government, and when it comes to a stage when they have exhausted all their benefit limits and they cannot continue with their treatment, so shouldn't there be a mechanism to help them? Now, it is unreasonable that after they have spent their $80,000 under the scheme, they should return to the public sector. Of course, we want we want people to use the private sector as far as possible, but we understand that we cannot do it in one go. The example you quoted is bound to happen. No matter what flexi plan you buy, no matter how high the limits are, they may come to a stage when the treatment costs cannot be covered by the scheme itself, and public sector for sure will receive such a patient, and our public sector is a safety net. So expensive drugs or treatment should be better dealt with under that mechanism. Dr. Kwok, any further question? Just one last sentence. That is not really a safety net for expensive drugs, target therapy medicine, for instance. The government doesn't fund them at all. Otherwise, I would not have raised at this point. I understand you are reviewing the topic, but you should follow up. If someone has taken out VHIS, the government has the responsibility to help this batch of people that have been lured into buying insurance product by the administration. You have the moral obligation to help them. You shouldn't say that because it's voluntary, it's up to you. Ms. Alice Mack, honestly speaking, I think VHIS is not attractive even with the tax deduction. I don't think people will be lured into buying VHIS because of the tax deduction. Rather, for we will only be attractive to people who have already taken out health insurance. They may be attracted to turn to certified plans. Without the high risk pool, I really have doubts about the effectiveness of VHIS. People will buy or not buy insurance products regardless of whether there will be VHIS. I think the effectiveness of the scheme is questionable, and therefore the government should put in place a high-risk pool, HRP, ASAP, so that the scheme can really be effective. According to the paper, the commencement date of the bill or the provisions is the 1st of April 2019. So do we have any deadline to beat? Is it that if we cannot pass the bill by the 1st of April 2019, the tax deduction will not be put in place? Deputy Secretary, we very much hope that the bill can be passed within a few months. And we hope that after the summer recess, we can resume the second reading debate of the bill. Otherwise, we won't have sufficient time for insurance companies to submit their certified or standard plans for us to certify. It takes time to examine those plans. I think there will be over 100 such plans, so it would really take time. We have to examine all the plans, the terms and conditions very meticulously. And it would take us 3 to 4 months after the passage of the bill to do that. And we should also allow time for insurance companies to prepare their publicity materials. So I hope that the bill can receive a second reading debate after the summer recess so that we can launch the schemes in January. That means insurance companies can only launch plans after the bill is passed so that people can take out these plans and then enjoy tax deduction, right? I am still of the view that without the HRP, we will only be benefiting people that have already taken out insurance. They will wait until next year when they can enjoy tax deduction after they have taken out insurance. To follow up on Ms. Alice Mack's question, can you tell us categorically the scope under the standard plan? Can you tell us whether the standard plan is at least better than 50% of the current health insurance products available in the market? Because Ms. Mack said that the only effect of your scheme is to attract the insured to turn to your schemes. Then you have to tell us how superior will the standard plan be? Can it be better than at least half of the plans available in the market? I can only say that there is no plan in the market that can fully fulfill the VHIS requirements. So all insurance companies are working hard, even if they want to switch, help their current clients to help, they will have to work out the plans first. And I think the VHIS is rather attractive in that there can be guaranteed renewal. Although there are plans that offer guaranteed renewal, but there are many that do not offer such a feature. Otherwise, if there is no renewal, then you have to take out a new plan, and then the premium will be very expensive. And then there is no lifetime benefit limit. The annual benefit limit is $420,000. That is another attraction of the plan. This attraction is available in some plans, but not all. And then we also include ambulatory procedures. Hospitalization is not a necessity. Again, not all plans allow this. So we hope that this is an attractive feature to attract members of the public, the younger generation in particular. And a couple may have a new baby, and we want young couples to take out health insurance for their babies as well. We encourage people to do that. So once a baby is covered shortly after its birth, then by the time he turns 18, he can pay for the premium himself. So in around March or April next year, if everything goes smoothly, we hope to launch a publicity measures. We want to target at those who are younger and the younger parents, they so that they can consider taking out health insurance for their kids. In the past, it was rather difficult to attract them into so doing. Of course, we can say we can't be 100% sure. We just want to achieve this effect. And let me stress once again that if it's just for the sake of tax deduction, you should not take out VHIS. Honestly, you should buy VHIS because the product is more attractive than current ones, and consumers should find one that suits himself. There will be over 100 products launched, and consumers should take time to choose carefully. There is 1 year for you to make a choice, and any time you join such a scheme, you can enjoy the tax deduction for that year. But some products may be due for renewal at around April, so we want them to enjoy as well, and that's why we want the commencement date to be the 1st of April next year.
Nope.
Okay, I'll be giving you more chances to ask further questions, but then there is one more paper that I'd like the Deputy Secretary to explain to us, because since the last meeting, we invited some community leaders and groups to comment on the bill, and we also received five submissions, and these five submissions have been included in a bundle given to members. For example, paper CB bracket 2, 1729 bracket 03 to 08. We have submissions from the Business and Professionals Federations, the Civic Party, the Medical Association, and also the Hong Kong Patients Voices, and so on. So I'd like the Deputy Secretary to respond to those first. I understand that you haven't given us a written reply yet. So can you first take us through those first, and then the floor will be open to members. Yes, thank you, Chairman. I'll give a summary response to the five submissions, because some of the views are repeated. First, on tax deduction, $8,000. So some of them have commented on that, and I've already responded to that earlier. Well, we believe that the cap would already enable some 90% of the policyholders to get 100% of their premium tax deducted. And also, with regard to the specified relatives, there is no limit on the number of specified relatives that they can apply for tax deduction. And therefore, we believe that $8,000 is appropriate. And also, for in the long run, we should extend that. Well, they think that we should extend that to all health insurance policies. We believe that we should first cover the hospitalization plan. And after this has been rolled out, and if it has been successful, then we can consider other options or scenarios. So that's a more cautious approach. Third, they hope that it can be extended to some outpatient clinic services. Well, we believe that some 70% of the outpatient clinic services are in the private market, and therefore we do not think that we need to provide an incentive for more people to turn to the private market for services. And some also said that the $8,000 is not adequate. We believe that if there is a need, they can also consider turning to flexi plans. Next is about the high-risk pool, whether or not subsidies should be offered to those in need. Well, at the last meeting, we already said that for the high-risk pool, there is no consensus in the community. That's why at this stage, when we introduce the VHIS, we would not like to regulate on high-risk pool. We'd be considering that as the way forward. And also for the regulation on administrative cost and also premium, I think we have already responded to that. We have measures in place to increase the transparency of premium in order to control medical cost and also to promote healthy competition in the market. Yes, Deputy Secretary, please do give us the written reply as soon as possible. Yes, Felix Chong, you have other questions, so I'll give you the floor first. Felix Chong. Thank you, Chairman. Well, yesterday, I think Professor Chen, the Bureau Director, said that the healthcare coupons can be used in the Bay Area. And for those who have taken out VHIS policies, if the patients go to hospitals in the Bay Area for treatment, they can also have such treatments covered under the VHIS. Yes, well, the design of the standard plan is a global plan, so the protection would be global. Okay, that's great. Next, as the Deputy Secretary just said, for the $8,000 is for the standard plan, so 90% of those taking out standard plans would have their premium covered. But then for the 1.5 million who would be taking out insurance policies in the next 3 years, and if they take out standard plans, only about 20 to 30% of those policyholders would be taking out standard plans, and 70 to 80% of those taking out healthcare insurance would be taking out flexi plans. In other words, flexi plans would be more attractive because they want better coverage. So I'm of the view that increasing the tax allowance is necessary. Chairman, if I'm going to move a CSA, would I be permitted to do so? Yes, legal advisor. Thank you, Chairman. If you're going to move a CSA to increase the tax allowance, then the effect is that the IRD would be receiving less revenue, so there is a charging effect, and if the government does not agree, then there is a chance that the president might not allow it, because there is a charging effect, because the tax allowance will go up, and as a result, the government will be receiving less revenue. So you can attempt to do it, and we'll see if the president would permit it, because the legal advisor has already told you his opinion, and you can make up your mind. Okay, any further questions, Dr. K.K. Kwok? Thank you, Chairman. First, I'd like to follow up on Felix Chung's question. All right, on the premium, all right, the tax allowance is $8,000 for the very young people. Well, that would be helpful, but then precisely that's the reason why the administration wants to do this. And if you look at the projections and the figures from the hospital authority and also the DFH, well, for this group of people, the medical need would be lowest. So those requiring more healthcare would be starting from middle age, for example, from age 65. Well, for those over 65, the medical needs would be 8 times higher than those below 65. So mostly it would be those who are middle age and above who would require more medical care. All right, I don't want to speculate on your intention. Okay, you're actually luring more young people to take out health insurance, which they're not going to use it anyway. But then for those who are most in need, for example, by the time when you reach 40, 50, that is our age, most people will simply find it hard to take out health insurance because the premium is going up. And also the administrative cost is not regulated. All right, 8,000, 9,000 or 10,000. And if you are unfortunate enough, because the administration does not regulate on the premium charged by insurers, and you've heard of loading, if you are ill, if you have hypertension, high cholesterol and high blood glucose, there is a loading of 40-50%. So originally it should be $7,000, it can go up to $11,000-$12,000. So for the younger people taking out the insurance, all right, by the time when they reach middle age, the premium will be very high, and therefore they cannot afford it. So for tax allowance, it should be linked to age. That's number one. Number two, it should be linked to his health condition. For example, if he is suffering from chronic illness, and what's defined as chronic illness according to WHO, hypertension, high blood glucose, high cholesterol and so on, those will be defined as chronic illness, and the administration should increase the subsidy. That only then would it help those in need. And of course, the most important thing, as I've been emphasizing, you will have to regulate on the administrative cost if you're charging $10,000 as premium, and if $8,000 is for medical cost, then that's fair. But then that's not the case now. All right, out of $10, some $6.3 would be used on the patient, and then 37% is on the insurers. So I insist that the administration should do more about it. And of course, I'll think about how I can move CSAs to modify the scheme. But then my question now is that for premiums and also the tax allowance, it should be linked to age and also the health condition of the insured, so that for the young people who have attracted to take out health insurance, by the time when they reach middle age, they are not able to take out health insurance, they would also be protected. So Deputy Secretary, can you consider offering different levels of tax allowance to different people? Chairman, I think I don't think we need a different mechanism to deal with this. As I just said, indeed, we'd like to attract more young people to take out health insurance at an earlier stage. If they have taken out health insurance at an earlier age, there would be no problem of them taking out or renewing their health policies by the time when they reach middle age. In fact, they can also top up and take out a better plan. So if they can do it earlier, that would help to deal with the situation that Dr. Kwok just described. So by the time when they need it, when they age, they would be able to be insured, because that would cover them until they reach age 100. So that's the reason why they should start early. And then for the $8,000, the average premium is about $4,800. And therefore, for the $8,000, that has already exceeded the $8,000 cap. And also for the younger people, from 22 to 44, the average premium is only $2,400 a year. So there is a lot of room for them to take out a better plan. The design of it is appropriate. We believe that $8,000 is not low at all. And also, for those elders in need, actually the children can also take out the insurance on their behalf. As to how many children will be taking out the insurance on their behalf, actually even their grandchildren can take out health policies for their grandparents. So by the time when they age, well, if every child can get $8,000 tax allowance, then for two sons and their wives, if they all take out health insurance for this elder, then they can get a total of $32,000 tax allowance. So that would already deal with the situation where the premium would go up by the time you age. Chairman, I don't think that my children would be taking that out for me, so I would just be thinking about my own affordability. If I can take care of myself, it's already very good. Okay, so all right, you're asking your daughter-in-law to do that. You're talking about ancient times. So for the younger generation, well, they have to repay their own loans if they take out associate degree courses. And also for the real estate is costing some $20,000 per square feet. So you're daydreaming if you think that your children will be able to afford to take out health insurance for you. All right. For the younger people, the average premium is $4,800. But then by the time when people reach 50, you will have to think about the fact that you have not imposed any restriction on the premium to be charged by insurers. All right, it's for the insurers to decide on the level of premiums based on prevailing market conditions. All right, $8,000 is already not enough for the middle age. Right now, it's already a lot higher than $8,000. So can you allow them to look at their own health condition and also their age, so that they can get a sliding scale tax allowance? So that would be fairer. Let's say if they're in their 20s, if you offer them $8,000, it's a waste of time and money. So they can already get it at much lower than $8,000. So why on earth should they be taking out a more expensive health policy? But then by the time when they reach 40, 50, they cannot afford it because the premium has already gone up. So in designing this tax allowance scheme, all right, for children or dependent children and so on, you can also have a progressive scale. So if you have one child, two children, three and four, the tax allowance would be different. So you can also have a sliding scale for those in different age groups. That can be a progressive tax allowance. So technically, is that not possible? Dr. Kwok, you're talking about two things. One is about age. Two is about health condition. I think he'll have to answer both. So Deputy Secretary, can you answer the two questions raised by Dr. Kwok? Technically, is it that difficult? Is it feasible or not feasible? Chairman, thank you. I'll try to answer the questions raised by Dr. Kwok first. Let me explain the IRO, the Inland Revenue Ordinance. That is for individuals paying tax. So what would be deductibles?
Under the IRO, an individual taxpayer enjoyed two types of concessions. First, allowance, tax allowance. That doesn't depend on whether their actual expenses. For instance, we have a single taxpayer, he has his own tax allowance. A married person may be eligible for married person's allowance, and he may also enjoy children allowance, and the allowance is fixed. The taxpayer doesn't have to incur any actual expenses for his spouse or his child before he is eligible. It is a fixed allowance. And then we have a concessionary deduction under the IRO that include charitable donations, expenses for elderly, dependent, residential costs, and also VHIS proposed, so on and so forth. We call it concessionary deduction because, strictly speaking, the IRO is so designed that there should not be any deductions. Now you ask me. In the UK tax regime, would these things be eligible for deduction? The answer is no. Now, for concessionary deductions require for actual expenses, although under the IRO there should not be any deductions, but we want to achieve some social objectives, so we offer concessionary deductions, and there must be actual expenses incurred. Now, for the VHIS, the design is relatively more flexible. Why do I say so? Take elderly residential expenses deduction, for example. Now, you can only apply for either your parent or grandparent residential care expenses. You cannot enjoy two. So under the VHIS, you can enjoy deductions for more than one policy, so it's already more flexible. And then in every year's budget, the FS and colleagues of FSTB will give regard to the tax or the revenue situation, consider whether the tax allowances and concessionary deductions should be adjusted. There will be adjustments every year. In other words, if the policy is not changed, the IRD can envisage that in the coming tax year, the tax deductions for VHIS might be adjusted. And every year when the budget is being drafted, different organizations may make views to the administration. For instance, tax bans have been increased from 40 to 45,000, and the progressive tax rate in the past was 2, 7, 12, and 17. Now it's changed to 2, 6, 10, 12, 17. The purpose is to lessen the tax burden on taxpayers. So we've also got tax rebate. This year, the ceiling is 75% or $30,000, whichever is the lower. So we have a basket of such measures every year. So this year, the ceiling is fixed at 8,000. Next year, it may not be the same. So the mechanism is subject to annual reviews, is that right? Every year, the FS will conduct consultations on the coming budget, and this deduction can be part of the reviews, right? In the past 10 years, according to my experience, there were revisions to tax allowances and concessionary deductions. And of course, there have been adjustments to tax bands as well as tax rates. I won't be that complicated. From 20 to 40, 40 to 60, and those over 60, there will be 3H black brackets. Can there be different tax deductions for different bands? Is that possible? Do you find such a design feasible or not? Thank you. From a legal provisions point of view, it is entirely feasible. Oh, that's good. But then, from IRD's point of view, when we implement such proposals, then may I remind you, then when we collect information on the age of taxpayers, but we have all given you our age. Now, sometimes it's not about the taxpayer's age, but the age of the insured. But we give them our age anyway. No, this is not about the age of the taxpayer, but the age of the insured. Sorry for my interruption. Thank you, Chairman. We'll have to collect a lot of data, and the database is going to be more complicated. And usually, the Privacy Commissioner will ask the IRD, why do we have to collect such an item? Because we have to do some matching. We'll have to see whether information from the taxpayers is correct or not, and that would mean administrative improvement. And then the tax return form will also be more complicated, and the tax assessment process will also be more complicated. But of course, that all hinges upon whether there is a need to do so under the law. All right, legal advisor, if Dr. Kwok would like to make a CSA, can there be any cap on the administrative fee? Thank you. The blue bill is about how tax deductions is to be made, and there is no mention of contents of a flexi plan or a standard plan. But if we take a look at section 26I, there is a definition. That is a definition for VHIS. And so long as it is approved by the Food and Health Bureau, then it is a VHIS policy. So if members would like to move an amendment, you may want to add conditions to the definition for VHIS policy. So although the plan has been certified by the Secretary for Food and Health, then the following conditions should also be satisfied. For instance, a certain cap to the administrative fee. This is just a technical issue. Whether the President allows such an amendment will depend on whether he considers it relevant. So a 26i interpretation, there is a term, there is a definition for VHIS policy that is add conditions to the definition for VHIS. All right, thank you. We have spent a lot of time on the policy issues. I understand that members may move amendments to the bill. Then why don't we start? All right, Mr. Felix Chung, you have a question?
Yes, I do.
Yes, I'll allow you to ask that question too. Mr. Chung, there is a mention of a transfer or transition. That is, you have already taken out a policy and you want to transfer or transit to a standard plan. According to the Secretary, current policies are not as attractive as the standard plan. Is that right? Under Secretary or the Deputy Secretary told us that he has reviewed many policies in the market, and he is of the view that the standard plan is superior to current plans available in the market. And he said that normally there is no need to reassess the application. Is it a guarantee? For instance, a person has taken out a certain health insurance product for 10 years, and now he would like to turn to the standard plan, which according to the Deputy Secretary is more attractive. The scope and also the benefits may be better. And well, for instance, the insured be required to do a medical checkup, and what if in the past, his cholesterol was not high, now it's a bit higher, and he has higher blood pressure, and he has started to take hypertension drugs. Will that affect the success or otherwise of the plan? Perhaps after a medical checkup, the premium will be different. Will there be any difference in treatment? Will it be different from what is promised in your paper?
Yes, for transition or transit arrangements, we require insurance companies to offer a choice. It may be a straightforward renewal. It's just that the terms should be adjusted to satisfy the VHIS, and there may be adjustment of premium, and that depends on whether the insured is willing to accept the new premium, so that there is no question of a new policy. But it may also be the case that the current plan is far too different from the standard plan, and then the insurance company may give this batch of clients a standard plan, not just for individual consumers or clients, but the whole batch. And when that is done, there may need to be verification. But if the client subsequently chooses not to switch to the current plan, that is okay. So there will be two scenarios.
Dr. Pokaki, Mr. Jung, you have a follow-up. So there are bound to be uncertainties. It's not as simple as transiting to a certified standard plan without any verification. I have two questions. Mr. Zhong mentioned two possible scenarios. And a policyholder is able to take out
policy coverage now, but when he wants to change to the standard plan and after a medical plan, I mean a medical checkup, he is not accepted, how would the government do that? Theoretically speaking, we should all be entitled to receive the tax deduction. If not, there may be a judicial challenge. For instance, I want to switch to the standard plan and the insurer refuses me. So I won't be able to get that $8,000 tax deduction. So I will then be prohibited from receiving this benefit, which is available to all in the community. And then what about hospitalization of mental illness? It is covered in the standard plan, though I dare not say 100%. I think over 80% of the private hospitals do not welcome psychiatric patients. Even if they do, they will advise you to stay in a private bed.
Let's say if there is a mental patient in one of the beds, how would that be dealt with? That would be difficult, even if it's a four-person ward. Well, even if just if there are just two or three patients, right next to you, if there is a mental patient, then you would not have liked it. So let's say if there's a private ward in a private hospital, the cheapest would be over $3,000 a day. So he's not asking for something extravagant. So for the sanatorium, is about $100,000 for a private ward, and for most of the mental patients or psychiatric patients, they don't need to be hospitalized unless they have special needs. Maybe they require round-the-clock care, and that would be very professional care. You would need to have a psychiatric nurse together with a psychiatrist and also a psychologist who will have to make an assessment on the patient once every few hours. I don't know if you've been to a public hospital. Have you been to the psychiatric ward? All the rooms would have padding on the walls because they might have violence inclinations and so on, and therefore in the rooms, many rooms would be padded in order to protect the patient, and then that would not be possible at private hospitals. So in designing for this, when psychiatric patients require special care, so do you have any such statistics? Would they be covered? Can I get your help? Do you think that there should be a separate item for psychiatric care? I'm talking about the inadequacies of the VHIS, because you just don't want the people to get ill. So other than protecting the inpatient treatments and so on, you should allow for preventive care. For example, if I have a high blood glucose and so on, if I wait for public hospital treatment, it would take me 2 or 3 years. And then if I've taken out VHIS, and then for outpatient service, it's not covered. But then if you're not yet hospitalized, then what can you do? Well, I don't need surgery yet. All right. If you can give me $500, I'm paying $8,000 a year for premiums. And then if you can give me $500 coupon, so I can go to a specialist for treatment. And then in the end, I don't need to be hospitalized. So please allow me to continue. All right. The WHO says that, the first thing that Hong Kong needs to do is to have better primary care so that people don't need to be hospitalized. But then the government is asking you to take out an inpatient plan. So that's most ridiculous. Okay. I've already joined the scheme, and I'm just taking part of the premium so that I can go to see a doctor. It's not just a psychiatrist, because in many specialties, before the patient is ill, he should be advised to at least go to have a check so that I can be allowed to go to see a doctor once. But then that would not be permitted. All right, turning to psychiatrists, this is the most outrageous part. All right, by the time when he has to be hospitalized, that there is very little that you can help him. All right, for private hospitals, they simply would not admit such patients unless they go to the private ward. All right, it would cost them $3,000-$4,000 a day. So for the VHIS, what's the premium? There is no surgery whatsoever, so it's just for observation and also specialist care. What can you help them? Deputy Secretary, now I understand what your concern is. Well, let me first repeat that the VHS is not an elixir that can treat all the problems that we have in Hong Kong. And as the Honourable Member just said, for primary care, that's another issue. We are dealing with that separately. So I think we should leave it to that area, because there is no question of VHIS being able to deal with all problems. So we have already added this psychiatric care is included already, because if you look at the products now available in the market, not a single one of them would cover psychiatric care. So that's according to my understanding. We believe that if mental illness is also an illness, then that should also be specifically included in the VHIS so that we can attach more importance to that. That's the main reason. We understand that for the premium, it may not be adequate to cover that as well, but then still, we insist on including that. Next, we also understand that there is a private hospital which will have a psychiatric ward. So it's not true that there is no private hospital that would have a psychiatric ward, so that the public would know that mental illness is also one form of illness. So that's a symbolic meaning that we'd like to bring to the VHIS for outpatient care and so on. It's another subject that has to be dealt with under primary care. Okay? I think the more I heard from you, the more outrageous I think the situation is. So I'm asking you, in practice, how would that be done? All right, there is a patient who is a mental patient. He has taken out VHIS. So from which avenue would he be able to get treatment? Going to the hospital? Does he have to be hospitalized? Deputy Secretary, well, let me repeat, the VHIS will be able to deal with part of the problem. There is no way that the VHIS will be able to deal with all the problems. Well, it's no use at all. That's my point. So are you suggesting that we should take it out? So you should help him so that he can get outpatient service. So there are outpatient clinics dealing with this, all right, in the standard plan. In fact, will outpatient service be covered? So under the standard plan in your design, outpatient service is not included, because in your design, you think that VHIS is for one thing, and therefore, Deputy Secretary, from that perspective, when you explain that to Dr. Kwok, can you explain from his perspective? Yes, the whole idea is to deal with hospitalization. So it's about hospital indemnity. So we are not dealing with outpatient service. Outpatient service is not included, because as we explained, right now, for public and private sectors, in terms of hospitalization, it's 9-1. That's why we'd like to adjust it. But then for outpatient service, it's 3-7. So we believe that in the private market is already very attractive, and therefore there is no need for us to increase the incentive for people to go to the private sector. But then, as I explained to members, we also have to do preventive care. So that's being done at the primary healthcare level. So that's another policy area. So there is another mechanism that's been done in tandem. So I'm explaining to members that VHIS cannot deal with all the problems, and it's never intended to do so. Okay. I would also love to understand your logic, but then there is no way that I can understand it, because worldwide, the direction that we are taking is to help the public. In particular, for those who are not able to get healthcare services, so that they can seek help early, so that they would not the situation or the condition will not aggravate into very serious medical conditions. Okay, I understand that you say that you cannot cover inpatient service. I'm not suggesting that for minor illnesses that should also be covered. What I'm referring to is the bottleneck of the service. We all understand that it's basically at the specialist service. at present, it's like this. Alright, if you pay $3,000, you can have the necessary body check. But then before he can decide if he can use the necessary check, for example, if he goes to a specialist doctor, the waiting time would be very long because he cannot afford it. Alright, that person has already taken out a certified plan by the administration, and whatever the administration does in terms of his policy, there must be a direction. You should, of course, try to make sure that people will not go to the hospital, right? So how come you're coming up with a hospitalization plan only without allowing people to seek specialist care? I have to clarify that we are not encouraging people to go to the hospital. We are actually saying that if an individual needs to go to the hospital, he has seen a doctor and the doctor says that he needs to be hospitalized, he can either choose to go to the public hospital or to a private one. So we are offering an incentive so that he can choose to go to a private hospital. So our policy is not to encourage people to go to the hospital, but then by the time when he has to go to the hospital, he can choose between a private and a public one. Alright, I think that's the way that your logic is confusing. Alright, I have $800 million. Of course, I want that to help the public so that they can get better service. So when you encourage them to go to the private hospital, it's not going to make them healthier. That's point number one. And second is about psychiatric care. So you've included that in your scheme. I'm sure you must have thought it through very carefully, or else you would not have included that. If you have included that and you say that for psychiatric care it will be covered if it's an inpatient service, that's very ridiculous, because for many mental patients it's going to deal them a blow, because you don't want them to go to the hospital. You've been following government policy for 20 years for psychiatric service. They want to provide community care service so that the patient doesn't have to go to the hospital. And then only the very well-off can afford it if they go to the private hospital. Well, you have to pay $3,000, $4,000. You're talking about $18,000 together with the doctor's service charge and so on. So if you can go to the for psychiatric care, please do not come to me, because it might take you 2 or 3 years. If you want to go to the public hospital, and if you're able to afford to go to the private hospital's psychiatric ward, then you can be covered. So you've not. So that's the way you put it in the paper. That's ridiculous. That's the reason why I bring it up. Even if nothing is included, you should help the mental patients. How come you're not allowing them to go to the specialist for several times? Because you understand that for 99.9% of the psychiatric service would not take place in a hospital. I'll extend the meeting by 15 minutes. Sorry, Chairman, I have to leave. But then you have to allow him to give a reply. I've an appointment with the CS4A. You will have to allow him to respond. Chairman, I can only reiterate that this is a hospitalization plan. So it's about hospitalization. It's not about outpatient service. And for outpatient service, that's covered by another mechanism. So that has to be dealt with separately. Then I'd like him to submit a paper in designing this VHIS, including psychiatric service, when it's inpatient service. You will have to give us the statistics as to how many people will be able to use that under the existing circumstances. Okay, he has already submitted a paper on a policy. It's about psychiatric care. Yes, I can also put it this way. Indeed, we do not have the statistics. We do not have the figures. So you're not going to supply that to us in the future. We don't have those figures with us. But then you can go and ask the private hospitals how many mental patients can go to the private hospitals and how much they are spending at the private hospitals. You don't have the figures. No, I don't think private hospitals would be required to give us those figures. All right, I'll challenge you. I'll ask the private hospitals for those figures tomorrow. Okay, so they are not required to provide us with those figures. We might not be able to give you the figures, but then we can try. We can go back and try and see if we can provide those figures to you. Okay, Dr. Kwok, you're leaving. Yes. Well, Deputy Secretary, I'll continue with the meeting. I'm not ruling out that we can go into clause by clause. All right, we can start clause by clause next time. Well, can I suggest this? All right, 19th of July. 10:45, can we have the next meeting then? I hope that we can start the clause by clause. And yet, I hope that the administration has promised to provide us with some figures or other responses, including what you suggested that you'd be moving a CSA. So before the 19th of July, please do provide us with that. And then on the 19th, we're going to continue with our work. I hope that we can move on to clause by clause by then, because many of the policy issues have been discussed and the policy is very clear. And I also agree that for other areas, we have to look at it from the macroscopic healthcare policy perspective. So here, I'd like to thank you all for coming. And also, I'd like to thank the Secretariat and also our legal advisor for their help. Thank you. Meeting is adjourned.
我想不想invite埋個members，佢哋有amendments睇下。
最好。